Hey, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm Don Maeda, and I'm joined today by my longtime buddy, Tony Alessi, team manager of the Motoconcepts Bullfrog SmarTop Honda team. Did I get the name right or mixed?
I think you got it right on the money.
Yeah. So, hey, Tony, this is the first episode of the Swapmoto Live Quarantine Edition. We've obviously been unable to access our television studio that we're normally in, so we are here today in Lake Elsinore, California at the Swapmoto Live offices, which is also inside the Jeremy McGrath Motorsports race shop. So thanks for making the way down. I think you checked in on the guys this morning. They're just starting to ride Supercross again.
Yep, they're all they all just got back to riding, and man, they're fresh right now. They're really good, and they wanted to start early this morning. Like, I mean, it's unheard of to want to be riding by 8 o'clock in the morning, but these guys were on the track by 8 o'clock in the morning, and they were enjoying it. You know, they're just excited to be out of the house, back on the track, back on their motorcycles. None of my guys have ridden since Daytona was over with. So,
yeah, I think you guys, your team, you grounded the guys pretty early as soon as it happened, right?
Yeah, as soon as we realized that there was no target date for racing, there wasn't a purpose. So at that point, we grounded the guys, we brought the bikes back, and we put everything on a kind of a hiatus until we knew there was a target date. And just recently, they kind of came out with a target date. They started with May 17th, which made me believe that I had 20 days to get the guys ready. So I brought them back and got them riding. But since that time, they pushed the date back again now to the end of May. So either way, they're here, they're riding, they're in good spirits. They're happy to be on their bike. So it's a good vibe.
Do you think that the end of May is going to really happen?
It feels so uncertain now, because every time that they give us a target, they move the target again. And so now we've lost our confidence, you know, with that, you know, especially with the last one. Yeah. But at the same time, we can't have guys come into racing underprepared. Mm-hmm. So I want to just keep them on the bubble, like on the simmer. That's my idea. Like, they're all fit, and they're all in good spirits, and they're all riding extremely good. And so I think at this point, we'll just keep that like simmering, and I think it'll be good enough. It's just, the problem is it's an expense to the team.
Yeah.
And with no uncertain event in sight. So that's the only part that's troublesome, which I have to work through that with my team owner usually.
When you guys made the call to, you know, pull bikes back and put everybody on hold, was there any resistance from the riders? Did anyone like, hey, I want to keep riding?
Or they did. They wanted to keep riding. They were disappointed that this was happening. But at the same time, they understood, you know, that this is the right direction. And I'm sure now they really feel that. You know what I'm saying? Because they all feel good. And let me tell you, after Daytona, our guys were whooped, you know. And so it was actually a blessing.
Malcolm was kind of quiet on social media during the break. Mostly fishing pictures and stuff. Mm-hmm. He posted a picture of himself the other day working out. Did you see it doing the push-ups with the dumbbells?
I did.
And I'm like, dang, boy kept on his program while he was gone, huh?
Yeah. He's fit. He's trim and fit. And like I said, he needed that break. Mm-hmm. He needed it. And so now he's got a reset button pressed, and he's feeling good.
Yeah. How about Hill? He went home to the Pacific Northwest, I think, right?
Yep, he went home. I think he was building houses and, you know, yeah, he was enjoying that country style life, you know?
Nice. And then I know Vince was pounding trails out at Greer on his mountain bike.
Exactly. But I'll tell you, you eliminate the riding element of the whole thing, and these guys, they're fresh. I mean, riding's hard. It's hard work. It's hard work to go out there and bust motos out and have to use your mind to, like, focus on jumping triples out of corners and stuff. It's not easy. It's a hard job, you know, and to remove that element for a month, I think it really helped the guys.
Yeah. Obviously it's a very different season than we've ever had, you know, like a break like this in between. It's given guys a chance to heal, to get better. But then at the same time, if Supercross resumes end of May, it kind of hoses some guys, like RJ Hampshire got his knee repaired, thinking that the race was going to start back in September, right? So kind of damages his chances at his good finish for the overall. But I think overall, we all want to get back to racing. I know it's certainly been a little bit boring, but What have you been up to since the break? I ran into you at Race Tech one day, and I think you were picking up suspension and putting back old bikes together to sell, or?
Exactly. So, like, as soon as we knew that everything was kind of stopping, we knew that we had a lot of material that we were using for practice. It was mostly 2019 material. And there's nothing wrong with that, because the 2019 material and the 2020 material is very similar. But I don't use my 20 material for practice. I use it for racing. So I realized that, since we're gonna have a tighter schedule and not the need for as much material, I started to put a lot of that 19 material together as bikes. I mean, we did it right. I mean, we took everything from scratch, framed it, and put them all together. Really, really nice. And we ended up selling like 6 bikes in 2 weeks.
Oh, nice.
So that was good. It kept the guys working, you know. Obviously, our race shops are good social distancing race shops, because they're each of the mechanics has their own work bay, and it's enclosed. Mm-hmm. So they just roll in there, they close the door. It's totally safe, you know. And so that's what we did over the last little bit of time. And then by the time that we got to the end of that and we were kind of getting the bikes cleaned up from Indy, we got the call that, hey, look, it looks like we're going to go back to racing. So that meant back to riding and practice and, you know, bike preps during the, you know, during the week. So we're back to kind of a normal schedule now.
Mm-hmm. So how has the COVID-19 pandemic affected the team? Obviously, some sponsors, I'm sure, are struggling. Have some payments stopped coming in? Have you had to stop paying or cut pay of the riders? Because obviously the mechanics are still working, right?
Yes, the mechanics are working. So in general, my boss is a good businessman, right? Mike Genova is A+. He handles stuff on the front side. So what does that mean? That means, you know, when he saw this going down, he actually called the sponsors and said to them, hey, look, you know, this is how it's probably going to go down. The races are going to be held in a stadium with no spectators, and the TV coverage could be, you know, not exactly what you're looking for, you know. So in a nutshell, he let them know, like, hey, look, you're not getting what you paid for. How is this going to reflect how we get paid? And, you know, so those conversations happened, obviously, right? So we realized the position that we're in now. Obviously there's going to be some changes made in terms of how we handle it with riders, how we handle it with crew. All of those things are going to have some level of modification based on the current, you know, paradigm.
Yeah. Crazy, crazy times that we're in right now. At the track today, this week, do you have the guys sitting far apart, or is it kind of mellow?
No, we have to do the right thing, right? So we have to, at the end of the day, we have to operate in a safe manner. We're a real company. Like Motoconcepts is a subsidiary of Leisure Concepts, which is a major corporation. So we have to follow all the guidelines. And so, yes, our guys are all positioned apart, and I mean, we're operating in a safe manner.
So, I mean, I think you've noticed our little social distancing window here.
So you're on the same page.
Yeah. But, the guys are back. They're all super fresh. Hill was gaining momentum as the season went on. Where is he right now? Is he better than where he was, or is he going to have to start building again?
You know, I thought at first, I was like, okay, how is this going to look? I was kind of projecting in my mind, and I was worried because Hill had gone to country living, right? So he was completely unplugged, you know, and I was worried how that would look when he got back. Obviously he rolled up on his Harley on the first day, he's just so talented, you know? I mean, he just was like right back immediately. So I have no worries. He's going to be good.
Yeah, that's good. How about Vince? So he's probably had even more time to build and strengthen his knee and all that stuff. I mean, Vince, you and I have talked about it before, right? Like, before I really knew Vince, like, I had the same perceptions that most people do. But Freezy is a great guy. solid dude, the nicest guy, would do anything to help you. You know, he just tries super hard, and you can't fault him for trying that hard on the track, right? So he's a great member of your team, and I think he's kind of like Genova's favorite guy because he's been around the longest, right?
Well, I mean, Vince has got a lot of qualities that people are not aware of. I mean, he's the best tester on our team. He can pick out anything on the bike better than anybody. So that's of great importance to team managers and, you know, future racing, you know, because he helps us, can help us develop the bike. So that's a key point. The second part is he's a team player, 100%, more than anybody. Whatever the team is doing, he's on board and he supports it. And that's strong. Because you got to have team players. And thirdly, I mean, he gets us really good exposure on TV because he's a great starter. He's up front. He's in every picture. He's in every video, every television. He's good, you know? He's a good asset to the team.
Yeah, is he a great starter because he's been on the team the longest and worked with you and Mikey so much?
He's taken, honestly, this is the truth, he's taken what we developed as a start technique and he's improved it. His start technique is now better than the existing start technique. I mean, Hill is on the existing start technique right now and he's pretty good. You know, he's like top five every week on the start, but Vince has taken that and made it better. And that's why he's 1-2 almost at every start.
Yeah. What about Malcolm? What's his excuse?
Malcolm, he wants to do his own starts his way. So, I mean, I can bring the guys to the...
How could anyone ever argue with Tony Alessi giving you start advice?
I mean, I tried. You know what I'm saying? I tried a lot of different times, but basically they want to do their own way. Yeah. You know, so it's like, I'm not going to force them to do it our way. So if it works, like sometimes his starts are decent, they're good, but when they're bad, man, it's a hard job. They have to come from 17th place, you know? But it is what it is. I mean, he's fast and he can come from the back. So is what it is.
Hey, so in this year at the Oakland Supercross, it worked out with my schedule to join you guys at your team dinner on a Friday night. And it was pretty funny because you had told me before when you invited me, I think earlier in the season, you're all, I want you to experience it and see what we do. And I was like, huh, all right. And then we get there. And obviously, it's a very nice restaurant. The food was amazing, but you know, all the riders, all the mechanics, Mike, his wife, you and your wife, you know, great dinner conversation. But then Mike got up and gave a little speech and a pep talk and where he sees the team going and his vision. And then one by one, everybody's getting up and giving a little update on where they're at, what they feel and everything. And I'm thinking, oh man, I hope they're not going to expect me to talk, but then boom, put me on the spot. But I had a lot to say because you and your team played an instrumental role in getting Swapmoto Live off the ground and running. But I thought that whole thing was pretty cool. Like no other team out there is doing that on Friday night. Every other team's at autograph signing, right? What is Genova and your vision for this one night like bonding?
So team dinners are a big important part of our race program. It's our opportunity the night before the race to get the mechanics, the truck driver, the riders, and some of the family, whatever that's around together to basically just, you know, focus on what's going on, talk about the race, talk about what's going on in their lives, and obviously keeps everybody together. You know, I mean, things can get a little loose, you know, before race. Sometimes mechanics go out, they might drink too much or, you know, whatever, or riders, you know, stay out too late. And in this kind of concept, we're all together, we're under one kind of umbrella, and we're doing the right thing, which is we're focusing on the race and we're talking about how we're doing. And everybody gets to get up and have their voice, which is good because when it comes time for interviews or whatever, these guys know how to do it because we do it every Friday. Everybody basically is having an interview every Friday. And we found a lot of success with this. And it's something that we think other teams should take a look at. I noticed that there are other teams now participating in team dinners. I saw it. Maybe we've started a trend that's positive.
Yeah. Yeah, that was really cool. I actually told Mike Antonovich, I said, hey, make sure you get to one of the Motoconcepts dinners at a race this year. It's pretty cool. But, hey, Tony, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors, but we'll be back for more with TA. Welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. Don Maeda, I'm here with Tony Alessi. So I was thinking about it last night, like the night before a show, I always kind of make some notes and stuff, but you and I have been friends since like 1990, I think. So I started at Cyclones in 1990. You were a CMC GFI locals reporter, right?
Right, correct.
So, how did you get interested in writing race reports for Cycle News?
I went to a GFI race, and you know, was there, and I was racing, right? Mm-hmm. So I was racing, and I remember that while I was there, Goat Brecker said to me, he said, "We don't have a Cycle News guy." Mm-hmm. You're going to be that guy. And I'm like,
he just assigned it to you.
I'm like, I'm going to be that guy. Yep. You're going to be that guy. I'm like, okay. I really don't know what I'm doing, but I'll try to figure it out. And so I called, and I think I talked to Kit, maybe Kit, yeah, or one of the other
Kit
guys.
Kit or Nate were the locals.
Nate.
Guy. Yeah. Nate.
That's
Rabba.
Who I talked to. Nate Rabba. Yeah. And he was like, well, we can't just let you start covering races. You're going to have to go do some desert races at first. And I was like, okay. So I did it. I hated it. I was like, man, do I really got to go out to the middle of nowhere and do these things? So I did a few of those, and obviously it was good enough that he was like, okay, now you can go do the races that you kind of, which ones you want to do, GFI, CMC? I'm like, yeah, I want to do those races.
Yeah.
And they're like, okay, you can go do them. And that's kind of how it got started. And honestly, I it was an adventure. You know what I'm saying? Like, taking photos, trying to talk to everybody, getting the right story.
And racing.
And then going back home after the race and developing, like, because in these days, you had to develop your own film. You know what I'm saying? So I'm in there developing, rolling my own film.
Were you doing it in your closet?
I was doing it in the bathroom.
Yeah.
Oh, and my wife, and my girlfriend, or my wife. Yeah, my wife at that time. Absolutely hated it because it had a smell, it left stains.
Oh, yeah.
And she'd walk in there and stuff was hanging in the bathroom, like film. So it was an adventure, you know?
You know, and all that effort was for a whopping $2 per 1 inch of type in the newspaper.
That is true, but I actually tied it into something cool at some point, right? So, that worked into like, oh, I don't have to pay to get in the gate.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I don't have to pay for entries. Oh, that's cool. Yeah. And then kids came along and they want to ride all these different classes.
Yeah.
Didn't have to pay for any entry. So at that point, that number was way good, yeah, because of the money that I was saving to try to do it. I mean, a normal weekend, you know, taking kids racing and mm-hmm. doing all that, $500.
Yeah.
And so I was able to save that, even mm-hmm. though I'm only made like $20 on the other side.
Yeah.
Saving $500 was golden.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's why I started, because Ken Fott was doing the local stuff at Ascot for CMC, and I was like, oh, that's really cool. And then he got hired And so then I approached Stu Peters and said, hey, can I take over the thing? And it came easy for me. Like, for some reason, English has been a strong point for me. But yeah, it was more so what you saved. I did it because I didn't want to have to pay to get in the gate and pay to get in the thing. And I never saw it as a career path or anything. And oddly enough, it led to this where I am right now. But it's kind of funny. But so when I met Tony, I was working at Cycle News and I was the locals editor. So you would send me your stuff. And I just always remember you would send the negative and you'd have it cropped out with a grease pen.
Yeah, I would do a proof sheet.
Yeah.
And then I would like, these are the good ones, you know, circle them. And I'd put who the name and the number was and all that and what class. And believe it or not, that was a lot of work to do.
Oh,
all
yeah.
That. It was a heck of a lot of work. Yeah. And in the deadline was crucial. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, we had to have that stuff in the mail on Monday. And usually the races were like Sunday.
Yeah.
So like by the next day, 24 hours later, you had to develop all the film, make the proof sheets, and write the story. And I was really never that great with like the grammar, so I'm sure you guys were always mad that you had to clean it up a little bit. But
that was my job.
That was your job, yeah. And get it in on time. And that's hard to do that. And but it was a good challenge, and I enjoyed it.
Yeah, I remember you were the most consistent contributor we had. You know, we'd always count on stuff coming in. And sometimes you'd go to two races on a weekend, right?
That's true. That's true. Sometimes there was two races on a weekend, right?
So we talked on the phone quite a bit because I was your editor, but I distinctly remember, I've said this in other interviews, I remember you saying, hey, I'm thinking about picking up a used PW for the boys, but like, I don't know if I want to go down that path. It's pretty funny to think about that conversation now.
Yeah, no, I remember like yesterday, to be honest, I was like, oh man, you know, they were riding those BMX bikes around and I was like, oh man, like, the next step is PW50. Do I really want to go there? Because I know how this could go. It means I'm going to be doing a lot of work on peewees. You know what I'm saying? Like, and having to commit to like going riding and doing all this stuff. And I was like, Don, what do you think? You think I should go down this road? And you're like, heck yeah. And I was like, all right, here we go. And I went and bought a used PW50 from Jim Hale. Mm-hmm. Who had one, who was the AXO.
Yeah.
And I think I bought it for $500 maybe and went back and initially none of the kids wanted to like ride it right away. They liked riding their BMX bikes. And then this kid from the track came over. His name was Sean Storms. He was like a 8-year-old, like older kid, like a good on a BMX bike. And I let him ride the bike around on a little like circle track that we had, like a little BMX circle track that we had. And Mike Alessi, little Mike at this point, was so mad that somebody was riding his dirt bike.
Yeah.
Oh man. And I'm like, hey, you didn't want to ride it. You don't ride it anyway. I'll ride it right now. And he went out and pinned it. And it almost crashed going over a jump and kept it under control. And I was like, oh boy, here we go. This guy can, he's going to ride.
Yeah.
He's going to ride. And that's where it started. And then Jeff kicked in. And then Cole Seeley was our neighbor. And he kicked in. And we all had a little group that we rode with like every day on these little tracks. And me and Cole Seeley's dad, Jeff, were out there with shovels in the rain, making jumps, just crazy stuff.
Yeah. And so that was when you lived up in?
It would have been Simi Valley, Moorpark area. Yeah. We lived in an apartment building. And we had these little tracks in the grass fields behind the apartment building. And they started out as just like little circle tracks. And every time Jeff and, you know, Jeff Seeley and I would go out there and build jumps and do whatever. And next thing you know, we had full scale stuff going on. And the kids were doing like race motos, and we had a podium and $5 for first and $3 for second and crazy stuff. It was fun though.
Okay, so it went from that fun in a little homemade track to all in, moving up to Hesperia, right, or Apple Valley, and just committing your whole life to your boys' racing careers.
Yeah, that was...
What was this switch that flicked? I mean, was there a certain thing that happened, or...?
Absolutely, 100%. So we lived in Moorpark, And we had tracks, and now they're not peewee riders no more. They're riding 65s, they're riding 80s, and they're pretty good. You know, they're fast. Like, I wouldn't ride with them anymore. I mean, like, they want to take me out, you know? And I'm like, I'm done with this. I'll just take them to riding. And so we go ride in the hills, and the cops would come and make us leave. And it got crazy to the point where, like, this is our tracks that we can ride, and we don't want to get in trouble with the police. I had the boy's mother down there with walkie-talkies on the street in case the cops come to let me know so that we can get out of there. It was just getting to where it was crazy. Then they flew a helicopter in and confiscated the bikes. It just got to the point where I was like, okay, I'm not doing this. We're going to move to the desert, and we're going to try to make this thing happen in pro racing. So about that time, they were like, say 13, around that age. We had a really good contract with Honda that paid us contingency at every race that we went to. So we had enough like funding to make it work. I sold my house, which I owned outright, sold my house. I cashed in my 401k, and I basically quit my job that I was at 18 years. And everybody thought, you are nuts. What are you thinking? Like, you're like, have you run a department? You got a good job, you have a good house, and you're gonna trade it all in for the chance of these two kids being pro riders? And I said over and over to myself, if I don't do this, right, I'm gonna regret this the rest of my life if I don't do this, because they are, I will have missed the opportunity to create this situation of pro riders. And so I was all in. It was insane. We moved to the middle of the desert. We went into full scale, like riding and training and everything and racing. And it was full bore. And like I said, we were all in. There was nothing else except for riding, racing, training, and getting the bikes, you know, to stay together.
Yeah. Well, that level of commitment obviously paid off. I mean, Mikey had a very, very successful professional racing career. I think he's still got his toe in the water a little bit.
Yeah, I think obviously his high point, no, Steel City would be a very big highlight. You know what I'm saying? He was 16 years old and barely 16 years old. And we went there on our own bike, a Varner built CRF 450. And we had a kind of a deal, you know what I'm saying? Because at that time, we were already in negotiations with KTM. And KTM basically said, look, if you're gonna go ride these pro races, your contract for the next year will be based on your result at these races. So if you were top 10, I don't know, I think it was like something like 200,000. If you're top five, it was like something like 500,000. And if you were top three at any of these races, your date, you know, like your races before you come to us, 750,000. Mm-hmm. So I was like, we're gonna try to get that podium. You know what I'm saying? So I knew that we had the level to make it happen. Like,
yeah.
Prior to going into pro racing, we would go to all of the pro tracks.
Yeah.
And we would learn the facility, learn the tracks, learn how to ride. We would go there and watch the pro race, get lap times, and then we would make a deal with the promoter or the track owner. And we would ask them if they could leave the track alone Monday, and we'll pay you to let us ride the track untouched from the race. So we could compare lap times from pro racing day before to Monday.
Yeah.
And it gave us a reference point of where we are. I mean, if we were like lap time wise 15th place, man, we got a lot of work to do. But it wasn't the case. Lap time wise was always somewhere near the top five. So I knew that we were good enough to go ride against the best riders in the world. So we did that, and you know, Steel City was a tremendous day. Mike finished third overall. He was on the podium with Kevin Windham and Ricky Carmichael, and I think to this day, I don't think that any 450 motocross rider at age 16 ever stood on the podium in motocross.
Yeah.
And now with the new rule.
I mean, it was gnarlier because it's like not a 450 class rookie, it was a rookie.
Yeah.
Right.
And not on a real bike. It was on a privateer bike.
Yeah.
And like I said, and now with the new rule that's in place where you got to be 18 years old to ride a 450.
Yeah.
I don't think that will ever be challenged.
Yeah.
That he was. And it was a great day.
Okay. So that day when Mikey gets third, in the 450 class behind Ricky and Kevin, are you like overcome with emotion and like tearing up? Or are you like, yeah, I knew this was gonna happen?
No, I was absolutely tearing up, 100%, because it was like, I knew he was good enough. You know what I'm saying? And we took a lot of heat coming in. I mean, obviously a lot of the heat was generated with the Believe the Hype.
Believe the Hype t-shirts.
I promise you, I didn't create that on my own.
It was DMXS, right?
Yeah, DMXS and Kenny Watson. It was their idea, and they convinced me that this is a good idea. And we didn't know. We're coming from amateur pro to pro, and these guys are the experienced guys. So we're like, okay. It did not go over well. Did not go over well at all. And but like I said, I'm still very happy with the way that that sequence took place. And to get that result at Steel City, it was redemption at the highest level, which creates emotion.
Yeah. Cool. Wait, Tony, we're going to take another quick break, but we'll be back for one last segment with Tony Alessi.
We put our heads together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula helmet. Designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios. Globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management with the Fly Racing Formula helmet.
What's up, guys? It's Brock Tickle. I ride for the JGR Yoshimura Factory Suzuki Racing Team, and I'm stoked to be back at the races. Planning my comeback to racing was cool to see. I have a lot of support behind me to get me here. FXR stepped up and invested in me, and I'm stoked to be part of them. FXR honestly kind of blew me away. All the product is awesome. The pants fit me awesome. The best fitting pant I've ever worn, and everything's sublimated, and it looks good.
It's hard to put our adventures on hold, but now is the perfect time to prepare for their return. Amsoil has your back with fast, free shipping, and ordering has never been easier. Just look up your vehicle, select your product, add an oil change to your cart, and check out. Spend $50 on Amsoil products, and shipping is on us. Order now at amsoil.com.
Don't try to be the fastest on the track.
Be the fastest ever. Work harder than everyone else.
Because dedication is everything.
If they say your goals are crazy, be insane.
Be fast.
Be the crazy one.
Be unstoppable.
One goal, one vision.
Hey, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FF Racing. Don Maeda, joined by my buddy Tony Alessi. So there's like way too much that we could talk about in a half hour show, right? But there's just been so many things that I can think of when I think of Mike Alessi and Jeff Alessi and you. But let me shorten it up by just saying, what is the absolute proudest moment as a racing dad you've had?
Proudest moment of a racing dad that I've had. I mean, obviously, Mike and Jeff both have had a lot of incredible races that it's just, you know, it's moving, you know? But I would say, in general, I would say that I really enjoyed all of the amateur years a lot. Mike was the winningest rider of Loretta Lynn's, 11 championships, and anybody that's raced at Loretta Lynn's knows that that is a very challenging event. I mean, you have to deal with weather, you have to deal with bike, you have to deal with starts, you have to deal with picking the right spoon.
Pick. Yeah.
I mean, you could pick 40th gate pick and you're the fastest guy. You're only getting a fifth if you're lucky, you know? Mm-hmm. So there's a lot to do with that. I would say that all those years at Loretta Lynn's were, you know, probably my proudest times as a parent of a racer. Mm-hmm. Because obviously it was just the parent and their son. You mm-hmm. know what I'm saying? Or yeah. sons in this case. And so we did it on our own. You know what I'm saying? Like, that was us that yeah. went there and did it. It's not like, oh, manufacturer or different mechanic. We were out there. I mean, I remember just sweating, you know, at Loretta Lynn's trying to fix bikes between motos and trying to get out there and make sure we pick the right gate and try not to fall over in the mud. I mean, there's mm-hmm. a lot. So it was, that was it. That would be it.
Yeah. It's funny because I've joked with you before about what a storage bank your brain is, like the statistics and everything. You probably remember moto scores at Loretta's for your kids, huh?
I remember moto scores. I remember everybody's birthday. It's crazy how you, I mean, I don't know if it's normal or what, but when you're in that scene, you remember a lot because you're living it mm-hmm. and it's there's a lot of passion and it just gets ingrained and burned into your kind of DNA.
Mm-hmm. Okay. On the flip side of the brightest moment, like, what's one thing you would change if you could go back in a time machine?
I mean, obviously that whole thing with the laser, I mean, I saw it coming and I wish that I could have reacted. You know what I'm saying? Like, Jeff Alessi hadn't been racing anymore. And everybody knows that Jeff Alessi is kind of a, you know, Jeff Alessi. He does kind of stupid, crazy stuff, you know? And so anyway, he wanted to come to that race at Washougal, and we were like, okay, you can come help, you know, mm-hmm. come out and help. And we went to a race Thursday night at PIR, mm-hmm. and I saw him messing around with it. But I didn't know what to think about it. I was like, okay, whatever. This is Jeff. He's screwing around, you know, typical Jeff. And then, whatever, that was fine. Then we went to race day. And Mike was having a decent race. I think he was like somewhere on top three, top four. So everything was going smooth. We were in no way at the same level as Villopoto that day. You mm-hmm. know what I'm saying? He was way better. You know what I'm saying? But for whatever reason, Jeff and, I don't know if it was the second moto, it was first or second, I don't remember what moto, but he was screwing around, you know, putting that thing on people at the line. I think he even did it on Malcolm, you mm-hmm. know? And screwing around, he ended up doing it out in the race. And, you know, like, we didn't know anything. Like, we didn't go tell Jeff, hey, go do this, go shine this in Villopoto's eyes. And
yeah.
none of that was the case. You know what I'm saying? It was just Jeff being Jeff, screwing around. And, I mean, obviously, everybody knows that thing exploded into probably one of the most...
Lasergate.
Yeah, Lasergate. And so, obviously, if I had a chance to, like, go back, I would have took that laser and crushed it at PIR and none of that would ever happen. It was really bad because Mike Alessi was innocent in this whole thing.
He was just there. He got docked, right?
He it was terrible what happened. So the first thing that happened is he got the biggest fine in AMA history. That's right off the top.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, he got his points taken away from that race, which dropped him from second or third in the series to something like sixth or seventh.
Mm-hmm.
So it was devastating, you know? And it was something that he had absolutely nothing to do with, zero. Mm-hmm. And neither did the team. SmarTop, at that time, was Motoconcepts Honda or Motoconcepts Suzuki mm-hmm. at the time, right? So Moto, absolutely nothing to do with it. And it was Jeff being Jeff, but because he had a team shirt on,
mm-hmm.
they classify that as a member of the team creating an incident.
Yeah.
And then the rider is responsible. The rider and the team now become responsible for the actions of a team member, right? Because he was in a uniform shirt. So the rider and the team took the full brunt of that penalty, which was tough.
Okay, same sort of question. Brightest moment for you as a team manager? I think
team
I
manager.
Know what it is.
Oh, hands down. Daytona Supercross, Justin Brayton. Underdog, not expected to do well at that race. Not factory team, not factory bike, but a team, in my opinion, equal to the factories, but never looked at that way. You know what I'm saying? I always felt that in that year, and even now, nowadays, that we're on the same page as the factories. They're not better than us. We're on the same page equipment-wise, management-wise, team ownership-wise. We're on the same page. And that moment where we won the biggest Supercross of the year with Justin Brayton, who was, let's be honest, in most people's opinion, aged out. He's 34, oldest rider to ever win a Supercross. And to make that happen, beat all the main, beat all the manufacturers, get the first win for Honda in five or more years at Daytona, was definitely a highlight.
Yeah. Okay, Tony, so what is Tony Alessi's life now? Besides racing, away from the track, you're remarried. And to me, it's just, I can't imagine myself in the position, but you have three new children.
I do. I have a super awesome wife, super hot. And yeah, so we've had, over the last few years, we've had three girls. I have a three-year-old, a two-year-old, and a one-year-old. And I have had no experience with girls. Let me tell you, that's a whole nother difference from having boys. So I've enjoyed the time, you know, like as they grow up, and man, they have some personalities, let me tell you. And so that takes up a good portion of my time. I do a lot with them in the morning, and I do a lot with them in the evening, and yeah, it's cool, you know, to have a whole new restart.
Yeah. And does it make you feel really old?
No, actually,
at all.
It forces me to have to up my game every day. I mean, I can't be tired. I mean, I have to have energy because they're demanding. They demand my attention, you know? So I got to step it up every day.
Nice. Okay, so we're about out of time, but hey, there's a pretty interesting event just around the corner, and I think Michael's taking part in it, right? It's the MX Fight Club.
Yeah, MX Fight Club. The race is coming up in about 2 weeks. It's on May 12th, and it's a pay-per-view race.
Yeah,
so that means you don't go there to watch the race. You've got to go on the website, which is Fight TV. And they put together a really good cast of riders. I mean, Kevin Windham, Travis Pastrana, Ryan Villopoto, Mike Alessi.
Damon Bradshaw.
Oh my gosh, that's crazy. But Jeff Stanton, six-time you know, champion. And they've got all these guys kind of assembled together, Jake Weimer. And they're going to race, you know, and it's going to be a good race. And I think it could set the platform for future, right? Because if this goes well, I mean, obviously the next step is to call Malcolm Stewart and Justin Hill, Vince Freeze, maybe Dean Wilson and whatever, because they want to keep it to X amount of riders, you know, whatever. And they could have a pro race, you know? The riders, in the first time in the history of the sport, are actually having the opportunity to share in the revenue that's brought on by the subscription to watch it. So they get X dollars to share among all the riders, and it's equal. And this is the first time that this has ever happened, and this is how it should be, you know? The riders should be able to profit, share for the race.
Yeah, they're the show.
And I think it's a good opportunity. I think it's a good platform. And I'm just looking forward to seeing how this goes and progresses.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it because I think I've been invited to go out there and cover it. Obviously, it'll be a live event, but shoot photos and all that good stuff.
It's going to be a good race. I mean, if it rains, Pastrana wins, you know? And, you know, if you can never, I mean, Ryan Villopoto, I mean, the guy is so fast, you know, like, how can you ever not think that that guy could be something? You know, I mean, I watched him at Supercross when he was getting ready to start riding Supercross, to do a race in Australia.
Mm-hmm.
And at first he was like slower than our guys. Then in 2 weeks he was the same as our guys. And then 2 weeks later he was beating our guys. It's like, can you count a guy like that out? You know,
and
then, and obviously there's so much experience with all of those riders, you know, they, I mean, Kevin Windham, I mean, he might, you know, not be, you know, like fit and trained.
Mm-hmm.
You can't count that guy out.
Yeah.
He can win straight up. I mean, these guys are fast, and it'll be interesting to see, like, does one of those older guys like Pastrana or Windham or Bradshaw,
mm-hmm.
Stanton, do they beat the younger guys like Weimer? And
hey, maybe it's because it's a tournament style 2-3 lap sprint, right?
Right. It'll be a bracket style race, which will be kind of like straight bull race, Red Bull straight rhythm, where they're together one-on-one.
Mm-hmm.
Anything can happen in that situation, you know? And I'm excited to see how it goes down myself. I'm looking forward to it.
Cool. Well, hey, Tony, thank you for coming on the show. I know it's taken a few invites, but I'm glad we made it happen. Enjoy spending time with you and the team. And it's been awesome for me to watch Mikey and Jeff go from little kids to full-grown adults and successful racers. So congratulations on that.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming. And you guys, thanks for watching. We'll see you next time on Swapmoto Live.